Good evening, everyone. Welcome to today's nephrology education webinar series. This is going to be our 166th series, and we are pleased to be starting peritoneal dialysis webinar series. This will be the first, and a big thank you to the International Society of Peritoneal Dialysis who will be taking us through this series. And our hosts who are the African Healthcare Network and our panelists who are on board, we do really appreciate. Our moderator for this session will be Dr. Scott Liebman. He's a professor of medicine from the University of Rochester School of Medicine in New York City. He's also a chair education committee of the International Society of Peritoneal Dialysis, and a former nephrology program training director at the University of Rochester, at the USA, New York City. So over to you, Dr. Scott, then you can proceed to introduce the topic of the day and our guest speakers. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much, Yuri. I very much appreciate it. Hello, everyone. As mentioned, my name's Scott Liebman. I'm the chair of the Education Committee of the International Society of Peritoneal Dialysis, and it's my pleasure to welcome everybody to today's webinar. This is the first of a series of three webinars. There'll be one today, one in July, and one in August, designed to increase awareness, knowledge, and hopefully uptake of peritoneal dialysis in East Africa. It was my pleasure to work on coordinating these webinars with the Africa Healthcare Network, particularly Dr. Lloyd Vincent and colleagues, and I thank everybody for their cooperation. I'd also like to thank Dr. Isaac Teitelbaum, who's the chair of the ISPD's International Liaison Committee, for all his work in developing these webinars. Today, we are absolutely thrilled to have Drs. Joanne Bargman and Tom Golper presenting two very important topics. I know Dr. Bargman has some clinical responsibilities that she needs to get to, so I will introduce Dr. Golper at the beginning of his lecture. But for now, it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Bargman. Dr. Bargman is a past president of the International Society of Peritoneal Dialysis. She's a staff nephrologist at the University Health Network and professor of medicine at the University of Toronto. She received her MD cum laude from the University of Toronto, was an exchange fellow in Melbourne for her senior medical residency year, and then pursued her nephrology training at Stanford University. Dr. Bargman has more than 200 invited lectures internationally on subjects very diverse, of course, including peritoneal dialysis, but also calciphylaxis and management of glomerulonephritis. She's the former director of a large peritoneal dialysis unit and the co-director of the combined renal rheumatology lupus clinic at the University Health Network. She has won numerous awards, both international and faculty-wide teaching awards for undergraduate and graduate teaching. And on a personal level, I could say she's always been very, very, very generous to me with her knowledge and time, of which time she probably doesn't have so much, but knowledge an immense amount. And I appreciate her sharing it with me when I have questions. And Dr. Bargman will present her lecture entitled An Introduction to Peritoneal Physiology.
Thanks a lot, Scott, and Yuri and the AHN. Thank you very much for inviting me to be part of this series. It really is an honor. Okay, I'm having trouble advancing my slides, so I may have to futz around a little bit. So as Scott said, I trained in nephrology and renal physiology at Stanford in California, and typical of American training, I never in all my years there encountered any patients on peritoneal dialysis. And then I was looking to come back to Toronto, which is where I'm from, and I interviewed for a position that opened up at Toronto Western Hospital, but it was working in peritoneal dialysis. And I said, well, you know, it'd be great to be able to come back to Toronto, but I got to tell you, I have never done peritoneal dialysis before. And the chief of medicine, who was also a nephrologist, when I told him that, do you know what he said? He said, don't worry, you can learn PD in 20 minutes. So that's about the length of my talk. And it's true that the principles surrounding peritoneal dialysis are in fact very simple. And it's been in the last 30 years that I've kind of learned like more nuances to it. But the basic physiology around peritoneal dialysis is pretty straightforward. So I want to talk about the interface between the peritoneal cavity and the blood system. So in this slide, you can see the capillaries, which represent the blood that's perfusing and superfusing the peritoneal cavity, is on your left. The peritoneal membrane separates it from the peritoneal cavity, which is filled with fluid on your right. So let's zoom into the interface between these two compartments. And I just want to remind you, certainly for me in my educational experience, this is just like what I learned in high school chemistry. And part of high school chemistry was a two-compartment container separated by a bidirectional semipermeable membrane. And that's how we learned about diffusion and osmosis and things like that. And that is very much what you need to understand about peritoneal dialysis. So if we zoom in on this peritoneal vascular interface, again, on your left side is the blood side, which is all those capillaries. On your right side is the peritoneal compartment, and it's separated by this interface. And if we look at it on a more microscopic level, you've got the mesothelial cells that line the peritoneal cavity. You've got the peritoneal membrane itself, which is when what you feel a pop when you put a catheter through it, interstitial tissue. And then on the blood side, you've got the endothelial cells that are lining all the capillaries that are perfusing the peritoneal compartment. And this is very important, these endothelial cells that line all those capillaries, because that is where the regulation of transperitoneal transport actually occurs, at the level of these endothelial cells. So how does solute get from the blood in our patients with kidney failure into the peritoneal fluid? Well, just like in hemodialysis, there's solute movement by diffusion and also by convection during ultrafiltration. You will recognize this from solute transport in hemodialysis also. So diffusion kinetics from the blood side of the patient to the peritoneal dialysis fluid is going to be based on concentration gradient. And the diffusive flux is going to be fastest right at the beginning, because for if you take the example of creatinine, you can have a blood creatinine that's very high, but when you put in fresh peritoneal dialysis fluid, the creatinine level is zero. So you've got a big concentration gradient between the blood and the peritoneal fluid. So the diffusive flux will happen very quickly when the concentration gradient is the fastest. And we just know by measurement that in most people, at the end of a four-hour dwell of PD fluid, urea, because it's small and easily diffusible, is pretty well almost completely equilibrated, maybe about 90%, closer to 100%. Creatinine is a bigger solute and a little more slowly moving. So, and I'll show you, this differs from patient to patient, but it's about 60% equilibrated between the blood and the PD fluid after a four-hour dwell. If you leave the PD fluid in longer than that, you're not going to remove more urea because it's already equilibrated. By that time, the dialysate urea concentration is going to be the same as the blood urea concentration. So even if you leave the PD fluid in longer, you're not going to remove any more urea down a concentration gradient. However, longer dwells are important for those slower moving uremic toxins. And this would be those middle molecules and larger molecular weight uremic toxins whose movement is essentially time dependent. And the longer you leave the PD fluid in, sure, you're not going to remove any more urea, but you're going to remove more of these larger molecular weight, slower moving uremic toxins. So this is a diffusion curve, and on the y-axis here, you've got the ratio of the dialysate concentration of the solute in question to the plasma concentration of the solute in question. So 1.0 would be 100% or complete equilibration. And urea, because it's small and fast-moving, as I said, will equilibrate more quickly. Creatinine takes longer to equilibrate. And these middle molecules that I was talking about before, really the removal of them is time dependent. And the longer you leave the dwell time, the more middle molecules you will remove. As I said, this is a bidirectional membrane, just like in the grade 12 chemistry. So you can add stuff to the dialysis fluid, which will diffuse in the opposite direction to the blood. So sometimes we will add antibiotics to the peritoneal dialysis fluid, not just for the treatment of peritonitis, but also to treat infections in the body. And if you're using, for example, something like vancomycin, where you can measure blood levels, you can, if a patient needs a long-term treatment with vancomycin for, let's say, osteomyelitis or some other kind of chronic infection, you can add the vancomycin to the peritoneal dialysis fluid, and it will diffuse across in the opposite direction toward the blood and lead to therapeutic vancomycin levels. So there's lots of different things that you can add to the PD fluid that will diffuse into the bloodstream. Fluid removal or ultrafiltration is the result usually of osmotic pressure. And this is in contrast to hemodialysis, where, as you know, ultrafiltration is produced by introducing a hydraulic pressure gradient across the hemodialysis membrane. But the results are the same. You get fluid removal and also convective removal of solutes. And this is relatively more important for middle molecules, just like it is in hemodialysis. Now, the composition of the peritoneal dialysate varies by the osmolality. So there's 1.5%, 2.5%, and 4.25%. In packages that are produced in European and Asian centers, this is sometimes done by a different form of dextrose. So this is 1.36, 2.26, and 3.86% dextrose, but they're all the same osmolality. So you can see it goes from roughly isoosmolar to uremic plasma, to more hyperosmolar, to even more hyperosmolar or hypertonic, and this would be expected to lead to more and more ultrafiltration. So here's an example, again, back to our two-compartment setup. We've got the peritoneal fluid on the right, the blood on the left, and if you put in PD fluid that is hyperosmolar compared to plasma osmolality, you have imposed an osmotic gradient. And you know that water will move from an area of lower osmolality to higher osmolality. So therefore, you will get ultrafiltration. But it doesn't just go across as distilled water. It will carry solutes with it. And as I said, this is relatively more important for the middle molecular weight and the larger molecular weight uremic toxins. So it will carry solutes with it by convection, just like in hemodialysis. Only here, the ultrafiltration gradient is imposed by an osmotic pressure, not by a hydraulic pressure. Now, unfortunately, and this is one of the Achilles heels of peritoneal dialysis, is that the dextrose, or the glucose that imposes this osmotic gradient, is going to itself diffuse out of the peritoneal cavity along its own concentration gradient. So speaking in these units, if you have a 4.25% dextrose solution, that this is the osmolality in it, and sorry, this is the glucose concentration. And if this is the blood glucose, you have a glucose concentration gradient that is really quite sizable. So glucose will diffuse along its own concentration gradient from the PD fluid into the blood, where it will be metabolized as it's diffusing. And that is why ultrafiltration is time dependent. When you first put in an osmotic gradient hypertonic PD solution, you will get rapid ultrafiltration, but it starts to slow down over time as you lose that osmotic gradient. And eventually you will reach osmotic equilibrium where the osmolality is the same in the PD fluid as it is in the plasma, and therefore you will have no more ultrafiltration. And in fact, as you lose osmolality, and along the way there's a lymphatic absorption of fluid out of the peritoneal cavity, you will actually start to lose your achieved ultrafiltered volume. And if you leave in the PD fluid long enough, you may end up with net reabsorption of fluid. So this would be, for example, someone who puts in a 2-liter bag of dialysis fluid and then drains it out, let's say 12 hours later after really long dwell, and they may have net reabsorption and therefore only drain out, let's say, 1.5 liters. So the time of the dwell is very important in terms of how much ultrafiltration you will achieve with peritoneal dialysis. And just by measuring it in lots of people, We know that, for example, a 1.5% usually gives a maximum ultrafiltration of about 300 mils, but the time to that maximum ultrafiltration is usually only about a couple of hours. And since we leave dialysis fluid in longer than that, typically, we will end up with ultrafiltration that is less than that and may actually be a no net ultrafiltration. And again, depending on the length of the dwell, you may end up with net reabsorption. The more hypertonic 4.25% typically gives a maximum ultrafiltration of about 1 liter, and the time to that maximum ultrafiltration on average is about 4 hours. So think about that. A 4.25% solution leads to, on average, about a liter of ultrafiltration over 4 hours. That averages out to about 250 mils per hour, which is really very excellent ultrafiltration. So why, when my PD patients come into the intensive care unit and the intensivists want to take fluid off, do they immediately shove a hemodialysis line in and do extracorporeal ultrafiltration? And the answer is, I have no idea. Because usually in most patients, you can use a hypertonic solution and achieve excellent ultrafiltration. It's just the intensivists don't really, I think between you and me, don't really trust peritoneal dialysis, and they like the idea of dialing up a measured amount of ultrafiltration with hemodialysis instead of just using a hypertonic solution in peritoneal dialysis. So this is actually computer generated data, but it just shows you a 1.5%, 2.5%, and a 4.25% solution. This is the amount of ultrafiltration. This is drained volume from a 2-liter bag. So obviously 2,600 means that they've ultrafiltered about 600 mils extra. But you can see that the 1.5% has less ultrafiltration and it dissipates faster and goes into net reabsorption. The 2.5% moves a little bit to the right, and the 4.25% moves even further to the right. And this is all based on the different dextrose concentrations and therefore osmotic pressure with each of these kinds of PD solutions. So ultrafiltration in peritoneal dialysis depends on three factors: the strength or the tonicity or the osmolality of the dialysate. With the higher the osmolality, the greater the ultrafiltration. The duration of the dialysis fluid dwell, as I showed you, because after osmotic equilibration, fluid starts going in the other direction and gets absorbed. And the other interesting thing about peritoneal dialysis is that you are dialyzing with a biologic membrane, the patient's own peritoneal membrane. And patient A may have a different kind of peritoneal membrane compared to patient B. So the permeability of the peritoneal membrane to glucose and water movement may be different from one patient to another and may be different in the same patient themselves over time. And that is really interesting. And like I said, it's not because you're pulling a hemodialyzer off the shelf where one is the same as the one next to it, but in people, because it's a biologic membrane, their actual permeability to solutes and water movement may be different one to the other, and even within the same patient over time. And what's even more interesting is that aquaporins, which I'll talk about in a minute, which are water channels that allow for ultrafiltration, may be different genetically in one kind of patient to another. And this is an important study that was done a couple of years ago that showed that there was a difference in ultrafiltration depending on the genotype of the water pores in the endothelial cells of the peritoneal membrane. So because it's a biologic membrane, you can actually characterize the transport capabilities of the peritoneal membrane. This is not a measure of adequacy. And in fact, I don't even think this is such an important measurement, as I'll show you in a second. But anyway, you should understand about the peritoneal equilibration test, or the PET. So again, back to our two-compartment model, the two compartments separated by a semi-permeable membrane. You've got your peritoneal cavity on the right, the blood compartment on the left. And then if you put in the PD fluid and you see what happens, you know that the creatinine is going to diffuse from the blood into the peritoneal fluid, and glucose is going to diffuse along its own concentration gradient from the peritoneal fluid into the blood. So how quickly or how easily does the creatinine cross from the blood into the peritoneal cavity? Well, you can, after 4 hours, see how much of the creatinine is in the dialysis fluid compared to how much creatinine is in the plasma. And that is the ratio of dialysis to plasma creatinine at 4 hours. And the so-called leakier the peritoneal membrane is, the higher the ratio of creatinine in the dialysis fluid at the end of 4 hours compared to what it is in the plasma. So someone who's a rapid transporter, and I'm calling it a leaky peritoneal membrane. In fact, it's not like it's got more holes in it or anything like that. It's just that the vascular beds that are perfusing the peritoneal membrane are more open, and therefore it is more of a sink for transport between the peritoneal compartment and the blood compartment. So a rapid transporter, everything moves faster. So the glucose is going to diffuse faster from the peritoneal cavity into the blood, and the creatinine is going to diffuse faster from the creatinine into the dialysis fluid. That's a rapid or a fast transporter. Whereas a slow transporter of what I'm calling a tight peritoneal membrane, but is in fact just fewer open vascular beds in the blood compartment, everything will occur more slowly. So yes, there will be movement of glucose from the peritoneal cavity into the blood, but it will occur more slowly. And the opposite, creatinine going from the blood to the peritoneal fluid will occur, but it occurs more slowly in these slow transporters. So these are equilibration curves. This is for urea. This is for creatinine, and it just shows you that these fast or rapid transporters, everything moves faster and you end up to a complete equilibration sooner. Whereas if you look at purple, which is the slower transporters, the dialysis of plasma urea or creatinine, it all happens more slowly. Now, because urea is small and so easily diffusible, there really isn't much of a discrimination among these different transport types. So because of that, we use creatinine in the peritoneal equilibration test because it brings out more the difference among these different kinds of transporters. So there's the rapid transporters in the red where you have the faster equilibration of the creatinine, the slowest transporters in the purple, and in between. So there's slow or low average and high or high average. And that's how you can characterize the transport properties of the peritoneal membrane in your patient. So this has important implications for fluid removal, because the rapid transporters, the glucose will diffuse out of the peritoneal cavity faster, and that means that the osmotic gradient for ultrafiltration will dissipate faster. So why would one patient be a rapid transporter from the start and the other one a slower transporter? It's an interesting question. There certainly are some indicators of inflammation, such as C-reactive protein, a lower serum albumin in patients who turn out to be rapid transporters. In some, but not all studies, diabetics are more likely to be rapid transporters. And this lower serum albumin is even seen in people who are destined to find out to be rapid transporters even before a PD catheter is put in. So it suggests, all these suggest that the rapid transporter status, which is more open capillary beds, may be a marker of inflammation. And some of the studies in the old days that showed that rapid transporters didn't do as well and died sooner may be because they're more inflamed, and that's what makes them a rapid transporter. The slow transporters, on the other hand, will keep the glucose osmotic gradient in their peritoneal fluid longer, and therefore they will ultrafilter longer and better. So if you look at the drain volume, you can see this inverse relationship where the rapid transporters in red who dissipate their osmotic pressure will have the least ultrafiltration, whereas the slow transporters in purple will have the best ultrafiltration. So it doesn't happen very often, but when we used to do PET tests, if someone was a slow transporter, I was actually quite pleased because that means that they would be more successful in ultrafiltering fluid compared to the rapid transporters. Now, it used to be called high versus low transporters because the rapid transporters would have more diffusion of urea and creatinine and other solutes. But in fact, when you factor in that the rapid transporters have less convective removal because they have less ultrafiltration compared to the slow transporters who may have less solute diffusion, but they have better ultrafiltration and therefore better convective removal. In fact, the difference isn't so dramatic between the two. And that's why in parlance, the use of high transporters and low transporters has now been changed to more of a rapid transporter and a slow transporter to show what's actually happening across the peritoneal membrane. Now, in my own practice, I have become less enchanted with doing peritoneal equilibration tests. It takes a lot of nursing time. The patient has to come in for several hours, bring sometimes they have to bring their bags and things like that. And in the end, I really figured out that I don't think PET is all that important in the usual management and prescription of a peritoneal dialysis. And if you subscribe to Kidney 360, it's going to be published. There's a debate on whether you need to do a PET to prescribe peritoneal dialysis. And myself and another author have argued that we don't think that PET is actually all that important. So if you're not geared up in your center to do a PET, I don't think it sort of spoils your chances of carrying out successful prescribing of peritoneal dialysis. Here's another part of the physiology of PD. This is a patient who went on night cycler PD, and the nephrologist in the United States, the higher the KT over V urea is looked upon as a very successful kind of peritoneal dialysis. And the administrator prescribed very frequent exchanges, 5 cycles over 9 hours with a hypertonic dialysis fluid to try to improve the KT over V urea. And the patient complained of marked thirst in the morning and had to drink several glasses of water. So what's going on here physiologically? This patient with rapid hypertonic exchanges is very thirsty in the morning. So let's go back to our two-compartment model, and we're going to zone in even more. And here's the peritoneal cavity. Here are those endothelial cells that are lining the capillary. And I said at the beginning that these regulate solute and water transport. So the 3-pore model says that in the physiology of PD, there's 3 different ways that stuff can get from the blood compartment to the peritoneal cavity. There are small pores between the endothelial cells, and this allows for the movement of water and small solutes. There are large pores between the endothelial cells that allows for everything, including larger solutes and even macromolecules. But there's very few of these. And then finally, there are transcellular pores right through the endothelial cell themselves, and they're called aquaporins that I alluded to before, and they allow for only the movement of water from the blood compartment into the peritoneal cavity. And it's been postulated with the use of hypertonic solutions that maybe about up to half of the fluid that is ultrafiltered comes through the aquaporins, and the other 50% probably comes mainly through the small interendothelial cell pores. So what does this have to do with sodium sieving? If you put in a hypertonic solution, you open up these aquaporins and allows water only to move from the blood into the PD fluid. if you measure the sodium concentration in the PD fluid at the beginning, it goes down, and that's because you're getting more water removal from the blood than sodium diffusing across the interendothelial cell pores. But who cares what the sodium concentration is in the PD fluid? The important part is that you're removing more water than sodium from the patient. And by doing that, you are going to leave the patient relatively hypernatremic, right? If you take off more water than salt from the patient, what's going to be left behind is relatively more salt than water. So the patient is going to be hypernatremic. And if they are, they're going to be thirsty. And it's a powerful drive. And the patients will drink themselves back into normal or whatever they sense as their normal osmolality. Okay, so that's the concept of sodium sieving, and it happens with rapid exchanges with a hypertonic solution, which activates the aquaporins and leads to more water than sodium removal, leading to the patient becoming relatively hypernatremic and thirsty. This shows that with the longer dwell, that the water and the sodium will eventually diffuse across the interendothelial pores, and there everything will settle down and equilibrate. But if you're doing fast exchanges, you don't have time for this to happen, and it's more this removal of water compared to sodium. So this sodium is held back or sieved at the level of the aquaporin, and that's why these short dwells will lead to more water than sodium removal, as I just explained. Now, there's a different kind of solution that leads to ultrafiltration, not by osmotic pressure, but by colloid osmosis. And to me, the way I think about colloid osmosis, I don't know if the physiologists will agree with it, is it's kind of the same thing as Starling forces across a blood vessel. And you will remember, here's like a blood vessel, and you've got a delta P or hydraulic pressure from blood pressure that's pushing fluid from the plasma compartment into the interstitial compartment. And that is usually balanced by oncotic pressure, usually by albumin in the plasma compartment, that sucks by oncotic pressure fluid back into the plasma compartment. You'll remember from your nephrology training, that is one explanation why patients who are very hypoalbuminemic, like from nephrotic syndrome, have a decrease in plasma oncotic pressure and therefore develop edema. So to me, when I think about icodextrin, it's kind of like the same thing as the albumin inside the blood vessel. It exerts an oncotic pressure that leads to fluid movement. So here was crystalloid osmosis with dextrose, which I just showed you, where maybe half the water movement goes through the aquaporin, half through the small interendothelial cell pores. That's with dextrose. With icodextrin, you've got these dextrans, which are kind of acting the way albumin does in a blood vessel, and it allows for water and solute movement across the interendothelial cell pores. But because it's isoosmolar, it doesn't activate the aquaporins, so you don't get the water-only movement across the aquaporins. And why that's important and why it's interesting is because if you have a liter of ultrafiltration with icodextrin, it's going to be more or less isonatric. Whereas if you have a liter of ultrafiltration with dextrose, about half of that is water only through the aquaporins, and the other is the isonatric through the small interendothelial cell pores. But on balance, half of that volume of ultrafiltration is just water. So you get more bang for your 1 liter ultrafiltration buck, if you like, if you use icodextrin, because you're getting more salt removal per volume of ultrafiltration. So that's really the introduction, the 20 minutes of how peritoneal dialysis works. A reminder that the peritoneal membrane is bidirectional, and it transports solutes through pores between the endothelial cells lining the capillaries. In addition, there's aquaporins, where you can transport water through these aquaporins across within the endothelial cells, in addition to solute and water transporting across the interendothelial cell pores. And ultrafiltration can occur either via osmotic or oncotic pressure. And this should give you a setup when we talk about how to prescribe peritoneal dialysis with a view towards both solute removal and ultrafiltration. So I'll stop there and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you so much. Sorry, I have a little cold or allergies or something. Thank you so much, Dr. Bargman, for that terrific introduction to physiology of PD. The questions are open. You can either type it in the chat or I believe there's a raise hand function. There's one question in the Q&A talking about the indications of PD, and I think Dr. Golper is going to cover some of that. So we'll leave that one till later. But there is a question in the chat. The question is, if one were to improvise PD fluid in an emergency setting, what would you advise? What would your advice be over different concentrations and dwells? I'm not sure I understand the complete thrust of that question.
If I would probably, if you've got access to the internet, if you go to www.ispd.org, there's a standards and guidelines document which you can access there by Brett Cullis, which looks at the use of peritoneal dialysis, and he talks about ways that you can devise solutions. I guess, you know, the important principles are based on the physiology that I just showed you, and the higher the osmolality, the more ultrafiltration you'll have, and that will give you more of recipes for designing PD fluids if you don't have ready-made bags.
Thank you. And Dr. Vincent has a very, very simple question for you, Dr. Bargman. What are the challenges that we could face with the introduction of PD in the African context?
When I was part of the International Society of Nephrology Council, I was charged with trying to increase the use of peritoneal dialysis in developing countries. And I must say, we could work with the catheters in terms of PD catheter productions and things like that, but the fluid, the production of fluids was sort of, for me, an insurmountable problem at that time. So I see, I think, you know, patients can do it well. You don't have to have like a big domicile to do it in. You can do it, you know, in small places. You need a measure of cleanliness, which, you know, shouldn't be a problem. To me, the big challenge is production of PD fluids in an economically feasible way.
Thank you.
Just a comment regarding the fluids. Rather than reinvent the wheel, there's at least three countries I would communicate with as to how they did it. India is one, China and Mexico are three countries who have faced the same problem some years ago and rapidly moved to resolve it. So along the lines of what Joanne said, rather than reinvent the wheel, I would and use the International Society to do that. I think we need to connect those people in those countries that I just mentioned who develop programs very quickly with the countries in Africa or the institutions in Africa that want to develop this.
Oh, and a follow-up question by Dr. Vincent. Would there be a need for a lot of storage space for patients at home?
Yes. Unfortunately, until we get to home generation of PD fluid, it's bags, and you have to store it somewhere. And depending on how often you can get delivery of PD fluid, it does take up a significant amount. We usually, when we're talking to patients about the feasibility of their doing home peritoneal dialysis, say that you've got to have at least an empty closet worth of space that you can store the boxes of peritoneal dialysis fluid.
Thank you. And there's a question on the Q&A about the possible complications of PD. And I would say to that, stay tuned to the next two webinars because we're going to talk all about that. So I don't think that's a question we can answer quickly, but we will definitely answer that over the next several months. And a question about what's best between PD or HD. I don't know. I mean, I think that's more, you know, it's more a discussion between you and the patient as to which modality is best. I don't know if there's any data that one's better than the other. I don't know if anybody else wants to.
I would just say that it's a lifestyle issue. I mean, for like 15 years, there were studies looking at which patients live longer in one versus the other. And I think it's a non-issue. Patients don't ask you, which one am I going to live the longest on? They say, which one's better? And it depends what they mean by better, but my interpretation is usually like, which is better for me in my life, not which am I going to by registry data live the longest. And so you've got to, like you said, Scott, you've got to have a discussion with the patients, and some of them just gravitate to one or gravitate to the other, one versus the other being more appealing, in-center hemo versus home peritoneal dialysis. And it'll depend on, again, like, well, like we said, the home situation, whether there's enough room to store the boxes of PD fluid and so on. So I don't think there's one that's better than the other. It's what is more fitting for the patient and their life.
And one thing about mortality statistics, I remember something you said a long time ago. I heard you say there's more to living than just not dying. And I've taken it to heart.
Yes.
Looks a couple more questions here. Apart
Scott,
from
Scott, if I could comment on the storage,
sure.
There have been a resource scarce environments where the storage is not done necessarily at home. There might be a day supply or a few days supply, but there could be a central storage site, which may be more convenient than storage at home. So somebody acquires their storages from a site every 3 or 4 days.
There's a question about how can we take care of the peritoneal membrane apart from prevention of peritonitis? And I think we're going to be discussing that in a future session, but I don't know if anybody wants to answer.
I'd say personally, the number one thing is preventing peritonitis. I'm not a big subscriber to the effect of glucose on the peritoneal membrane. I think there's more important issues, and just prevention of peritonitis would be the number one thing to try to protect the peritoneal membrane.
Thank you. There's a question for the if the maximum UF with PD is within the first 4 hours, can we change the fluid every 4 hours for ICU patients? Basically, what's the best approach if you want to remove fluid in an ICU patient?
Yes, absolutely. If you might have to get in a fight with the intensivists who want to do the hemodialysis, but if you use the 4.25% solution, you can remove a ton of fluid. And you're right, I would do perhaps every 4 hours or so. Don't do every 2 hours thinking that's even better, because there's a lot of lost time when you have to like drain out and infuse in, and it becomes less efficient. So I'd say like 4.25% solutions every 4 hours, you should be able to get super ultrafiltration in the ICU patient.
And I think there's one more comment, which I think is interesting. For patients with lack of space, you could actually use the PD fluid boxes as a table or a bed and kind of do double duty to fit them in your house. So sounds good. All right. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Bargman. We appreciate your time.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. And I know you have to run, so we do appreciate you taking time out of your busy schedule to join us.
Okay. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Bargman. Thank you very, very much. Extremely grateful for coming on. Thank you so much.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. So the next talk will be given by Dr. Tom Golper. And Dr. Golper has a vast experience in PD. In addition to his faculty position, where he's professor of medicine for a long time at Vanderbilt University, he's had many, many positions of organizational leadership, including with the ISPD, with the International Society for Blood Purification, and with KDOQI, and with the USRDS. And Dr. Golper helped establish Home Dialysis University, which is a wonderful program to educate nephrology fellows who probably don't get enough of this in their own fellowships. And in addition to co-founding it, he ran it for umpteen years, and it was always the most successful program that I heard the fellows talk about. Dr. Golper, now Professor Emeritus at Vanderbilt and a part-time professor of medicine at the Robert Lerner College of Medicine at the University of Vermont. And again, on a personal level, I will say Dr. Golper is one of the most passionate educators about home dialysis that I have ever met, and his enthusiasm for the subject is contagious. And the title of his presentation is Why Choose PD and the Patient Selection Process.
Are you seeing my slides? Okay. Are we all set?
Yes,
we see that.
Yes.
Okay. So I'm hoping that, first of all, I want to thank you for asking me to participate in this. And I have given you my email address. And if people want to email me questions, if they're too shy to ask them and they would prefer to email, go right ahead. So I think that the choice of peritoneal dialysis is really the intersection of patient suitability and modality decisions. Now, I realize that there may not be options available, but when Dr. Teitelbaum asked me to involve myself in this course, he said, just talk as if you were talking to patients and thinking that way. So that's the attitude I'm bringing. And I've tried to moderate this to a potential resource limited environment. And you'll see some of those comments on the side. Now, okay. And in the U.S., we usually give conflicts of interest, and I don't think I have any relevant to this discussion. But again, my email address is there. Okay, Scott, go forward. There you go. So in the United States, dialysis is growing. We think that's due to an increased incidence of end-stage kidney disease. But also the census of PD patients is going up because mortality is going down and technique survival is increasing. But even in the U.S. in 2024, we still have many barriers. Now, in 2019, President Trump made a major initiative to get more patients on home dialysis. Next slide, Scott. And so so that explains what's going on in the U.S., but the growth of PD worldwide. The growth of PD worldwide is the fastest of any kidney replacement therapy. And the rationale for that is its simplicity and cost, which we'll come back to over the next few slides. Next slide then. So in the United States, home dialysis patients have a slightly different tendency. No, stay back. Is that you, Scott, going, or is that the system automatically moving?
No, that was me just trying to make sure I was on the right page on my screen, but then it accidentally advanced it. I'm still getting the hang of it, but I'm working on it.
All right. So in the United States, the patients that choose to go home in general have better support systems. They have better insurance. They're motivated to go home, and they're usually under nephrology care longer. They have less comorbidities, and as a consequence of all these, they have better outcomes. Now, the next slide, Scott. So let's take those same arguments and look at elsewhere outside the United States. So the better support systems in the U.S., but that's they're simple support systems, and so PD may be very feasible in other environments. The governments who pay for a lot of the peritoneal dialysis or any dialysis at all prefer cheaper therapy, and I'll show you the cost of therapy in just a moment. And the highest motivation for a patient is when they have no other options. And if peritoneal dialysis is their only option, they're likely to choose peritoneal dialysis if the option is peritoneal dialysis or death. And again, we'll come back to that concept. Less comorbidities doesn't matter. If peritoneal dialysis is your only option for end-stage kidney disease therapy, then comorbidities is not an issue. And when the outcome is death, alive and functioning is a better outcome than death. Next slide. So what about the physicians that recommend home dialysis? Well, they tend to be doctors that provide longitudinal care to patients with chronic kidney disease. They're committed to integrated care, and I'll talk about that in just a moment. They firmly believe in home dialysis, and as Scott alluded to earlier, that is a passion of mine. They're trained in home dialysis, and for those of you that came on early, you heard Dr. Bargman talk about the colleagues around the world that she's been involved with in training about home dialysis. They have to be committed because it's not always easy to do and set up a home dialysis program. You have to be able to be willing to build and maintain systems, clinics, procedure centers, argue for a designated hospital ward that takes care of peritoneal dialysis patients. You need to be willing to recruit partners and colleagues. And by that, NPs or nurse practitioners, PAs or physician assistants, radiologists, surgeons, other nephrologists, you will experience better outcomes, and you will be aware of cost. So we call that cost consciousness. Next slide. As I said, we would come back to expense, and these are governmental arguments as well as personal arguments. So the most expensive therapy and the least profitable is in-center hemodialysis performed more than 12 times a month. But you can see the downgoing arrow that the least expensive, and then if this is a for-profit institution, the most profitable will be some form of peritoneal dialysis. Next slide. Which I've highlighted here. So you can see that the cheapest forms and most profitable, least expensive, are going to be, as highlighted in yellow, some form of peritoneal dialysis. Okay, Scott, next slide. Now, what do I mean by integrated care? So if you go from the left side of the chart to the right, you see chronic kidney disease to pre-end stage, to initial introduction of some type of therapy, and then the continuing care. And if that continuing care involves various forms of dialysis and transplant, you can see from the circle at the top that all those options are potentially available. And as I'll mention later, there will be transitioning from one form of therapy to another. Of course, the most desirable transition is from any form of dialysis to a transplant. But unfortunately, there are other transitions. One might not do well with one form of dialysis and then transfers to another. So this being able to perform all of these therapies are what we call integrated care. And we'll come back to this slide later in the talk. Next slide, Scott. Now, I was asked to talk about suitability, and I'm going to compare everything to in-center hemodialysis, although I mentioned earlier that suitability can be compared to no dialysis at all and eventual death. But right now, let's do this comparison to in-center hemodialysis. So from the patient's perspective, there's tremendous convenience in scheduling home dialysis at home. There's independence. There's less swings in physical condition and metabolic condition, and the patients will feel some semblance of control. On the other hand, some arguments against it. Some patients will say, I don't want to make my home into a hospital or a medical facility. We had the discussion just a moment ago on space requirements. Patients don't want to be disciplined. They'd rather have somebody else do this. They may find it an inconvenience in their lifestyle. Now, to me, that's a trade-off, but some patients may prefer no inconvenience. It takes time to train. For peritoneal dialysis, it might take a week, it might take longer, and then visits to the training center or the dialysis unit. Now, let's look at the suitability from the standpoint of the nephrologist. Well, you have to have a home or some similar secure space. We had that discussion. You have to have an intact peritoneal cavity, as Joanne described. And it can't conflict with other medical issues. For example, if you have an open abdominal wound, that's another medical issue. Nephrologists may feel that the patient isn't disciplined enough to do it, and the overall health status may be poor. So these are some arguments for suitability for patients on peritoneal dialysis. Next slide, Scott. So how about blood pressure? We talked about medical suitability. Let's talk about blood pressure. It's a very common feature of end-stage kidney disease. And again, I've got a downward arrow going from the worst control requiring the most medications to all the types of dialysis therapies that give you the best control and the least medications. And if you go to the next slide, Scott, it highlights that peritoneal dialysis is right in the middle. That if somebody were doing hemodialysis at home six nights a week, they might not be on any blood pressure medicine whatsoever. So you can see that's the lowest category if you follow the arrow going down. Now, Joanne and Scott talked about mortality just a minute ago, and there are lots of papers dealing with this, but go to the next slide, Scott. The consensus is that there's lower mortality in PD, which is not really argued, but the reason is that's probably patient selection. I don't personally think that PD is a superior therapy to hemodialysis. I do think that patients that are motivated to go home, for all the arguments I made just a few minutes ago, is the reason for the lower mortality in patients that choose PD. So I don't even like to see comparisons between PD versus hemo, because the patient selection is the difference, in my opinion. So that's why I've overridden all these articles here with the with my opinion on the consensus. Next slide, Scott. Now, Mr. Nephrologist or Dr. Nephrologist, if you had to do dialysis, what would you do? And so when this was asked of the doctors, you can see the response here. So these are doctors in the U.S. There may have been some Canadian doctors in this, but these were certainly North American nephrologists. And look here. So this was, even though it was some years ago, peritoneal dialysis was almost twice this next choice for if you had to do dialysis, what would you do? So how do we get more patients to do home dialysis? And again, this is oriented towards, as I was instructed, what I see in the United States. Well, everybody has to be involved and learn about the therapy. That includes the physicians, in particular the nephrologist, but it also includes the hospitals and organizations that are associated with quality, and that's what those initials ACO and ESCO stand for. But how about the other providers, the primary care physicians, nurses, technicians? They need to have some understanding of what dialysis is and isn't. And the payers, for us in the United States, we have private insurers, which we call commercial insurance, and we have government insurance of several different kinds. But those payers have to understand the value of home dialysis. And then, of course, the patient and the family. And that occurs during progressive chronic kidney disease. Now, as you heard in the discussion from Dr. Bargman's talk, there are some patients that present brand new to the emergency room. And so hospitals or institutions establishing what we call urgent start peritoneal dialysis programs now represent almost 20% of all the starts of peritoneal dialysis in the United States. We also have what's called transitional care units, which are special units for patients who are presenting with end-stage kidney disease, whether that's for hemodialysis or peritoneal dialysis. And in these transitional care units, there's several different types of education programs, which leads to the next slides. To educate patients about dialysis, one has to appreciate that people are different. Now, that should be an obvious understatement, but it isn't always an understatement. People's background are different, their ethnicity, their life experiences, independent of background and ethnicity. They're carrying different disease burdens to their end-stage kidney disease. What are their life expectancies? The life expectancy of a 75-year-old American is clearly different than a 25-year-old American. And then the exposure to the health system. And I say that in the context of somebody who has had no exposure to a health system and now is. What are our expectations of that patient? What is our understanding of what they understand about the health system? And so, and maybe that health system had no nephrologist. Maybe there were no internal medicine specialists. Maybe there were only nurses or field workers as their sole experience with the health system. So you can see that the education for such a patient will be different than one who's been into a sophisticated health system all of their life. Next slide. Now, what physicians are obligated to do, in my opinion, is to understand the characteristics of the individual, the characteristics of the environment. And I provided my slides to the organizers, and I very much urge people to look at this paper from 1995, and I would hope it increases your sensitivity to what is the the makeup of patients and why patients choose a certain way to do things, why they behave a certain way, and hopefully you can adapt the right therapy for that patient. But this is, I've glean this slide from this paper, and I urge people to actually spend time and look at the words on this slide. It does matter and will markedly improve your sensitivity to patient interests. Next slide. So prudent decisions require education. And there's two types of education. The patient has to learn about the therapy and the doctor has to learn about the patient. Two critical forms of education. Now, when do we start therapy? So the rate of change is the most dependable predictor. If they're losing kidney function rapidly, they're going to get on dialysis much more quickly. Certainly in North America, and this includes Canada, the United States, these risk prediction equations are turning out to be very helpful. Now, who would we start the training or the teaching about options? Well, if the GFR is less than 30, if you need a creatinine level in milligrams per DL, roughly 3 to 4. But remember, the steps in preparation for the need for dialysis are iterative. And what do I mean by that? The process includes at least 3 sets of parties. Maybe 4, but let's put the patient and the family, and I put family plus here, which means it could be extended family, that could be close friends of the patient. And so at the top is the nephrologist. On the left side are the nurses that will be involved with the training for home dialysis. And on the right side could be a separate educator program, which is fairly common in the United States and Canada. But what about all the other healthcare providers? And in this case, that could be the primary care physician. That could be an endocrinologist, a cardiologist. So there are the primary care doctor. So there are lots of other people that should be providing input. And you can see from the arrows, the input should be directly to the nephrologist and also directly to the patient. Now, in an ideal situation, as people progress towards end-stage kidney disease, the frequency of visits should go up. Now, I heard during the discussion talking about patients presenting to the emergency room without any preparation. So they wouldn't even be on this slide. They'd be to the far right and even off the edge of the slide. But ideally, to help patients get prepared for end-stage kidney disease, the frequency of visits should go up as they move towards stage 5. So the optimal start is going to vary. If they don't have other conditions, they may not even need to be in a hospital to start dialysis. Have we had time to discuss all these options with them? We have to make that time. And are they ready for dialysis with a permanent access? So in peritoneal dialysis, that's a catheter that's in place, it's had a chance to heal. In hemodialysis, that may mean a AV fistula or an AV graft. So I want to come back to my concept of integrated care, and I want to do that in the context of decisions that we help patients make. So the first decision is active medical management, previously called conservative care, then ultimately death related to uremia or other similar medical conditions, and that would be compared to renal or kidney replacement therapy. And under the concept of conservative care, the term active medical management has been preferred because it is active, it's not passive. An example would be diuretics for volume control, perhaps bicarbonate or some similar supplement to correct acidosis and potassium. So these are things that can be done instead of dialysis, which will prolong life, and we'll call that active medical management, previously called conservative therapy. Next slide. Well, that was decision 1. And so now let's assume that our patient has chosen renal replacement therapy. So then can we do a preemptive transplant? Or if a preemptive transplant is not available, dialysis. So that I call decision 2. Let's say that transplant's not available and dialysis is the decision. Then what's the decision then? Is there an in-center dialysis program available? And is that what the patient prefers? Or would the patient prefer home dialysis? And I call that decision three. Now, let's say that they decide, or there is no in-center dialysis program available, and the only dialysis that's available is home dialysis. And now they're faced with, well, are you going to do hemodialysis at home or peritoneal dialysis at home? And I call that decision four. So let's go over that decision, even though I realize in a potentially resource-poor environment, one may not have the option of hemodialysis at home, but let's assume that perhaps you do have that option. So this was a study out of Australia looking at why patients in this situation of Australia, why a patient might choose peritoneal dialysis at home or why they might choose hemodialysis at home. And I'll let you take a moment and you can read these choices. But I've been doing this for 40 years, and those aren't the reasons I see. And I've listed mine here. And for me, the decision of one form of therapy over another is training time. It takes a lot longer to train for hemodialysis than it does PD. And patients say, oh, that settles it. Every now and then somebody says, well, I don't want a fistula in my arm or a graft in my arm. Every now and then you'll hear treatment schedules and portability and fear of needles, perceived complexity, space, which we discussed earlier, and need for a helper. But all these pale in significance in my experience of doing this for 45 years is training time is what decides American patients whether they'll choose PD or hemo. Now, there are some contraindications. As Joanne talked about earlier, you've got to have a functioning peritoneum. Now, how might your peritoneum be dysfunctional? Well, surgery, very scarring surgery, could be congenital. You need some place to do it. So homeless is perhaps an extreme example, but you need a place to do dialysis at home. I've come back to my integrated care model, and we're down to decision five, and for this particular audience, we're dealing with to the right under peritoneal dialysis, whether it's ambulatory peritoneal dialysis or automated peritoneal dialysis. And that's really not a point to be made here and now, but in the United States and certainly in our society, that is an important decision as to whether somebody would opt for CAPD, manual exchanges versus automated. So one thing in Western society is we have to move away from just, well, what are your options to what's the best thing for this patient over their lifetime. So I call that leveraging all modalities, which of course include hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis, in-center dialysis of any kind, and transplant. And what is the right therapy for that patient now? That's the key. And the other advice I give everybody is don't disparage any therapy. There's no reason to do that to a patient who may need that therapy later. It hurts to hear somebody say, oh, I wouldn't do this for a bad reason, because that patient may be backed into a corner and have to do that therapy. So there's no reason to do that. I encourage flexibility, open-mindedness, and continuing education. So what is this life plan? Well, it's a roadmap. And how do we get patients to live the way they want to live? So that could be length, it could be quality, it could be both. To do so, you have to anticipate what are the risks. You have to think ahead. We're the doctors. We're the ones that are more aware of this than patients are. And we need to structure the decisions for the long haul, the long term, and avoid the trap of short-term thinking. And we must avoid that trap. The other thing is getting patient buy-in. And I think the number one job of a physician is to listen. And what did you hear? What did you learn? What do you think? to get the understanding of the patient is really important, and because then you'll learn what they misunderstood and you can correct it. So listen and respond, establish that trusting relationship is important. Now, a survey was done, which was international, and the reference for that is this Manera paper that I've given the citation below. And I've highlighted the rankings by U.S. patients, which it differed slightly from the international patients. And in the U.S. patients, mortality was not even in the top three. So this survey that you're seeing here is all the patients, and a subset of the paper was just the U.S. But in the U.S. patients, mortality was not even in the top three for decision making. This was a ranking by categories, and I highlighted a couple things. One, women preferred to men referred flexibility of time, probably because they're doing childcare, and the older patients prioritized ability to travel. Now, whether that's applicable to your patients, I don't know, but it might be. And reading this paper from Manera, which I said includes, I think, at least four countries were involved in this paper, take into mind what motivates your patients to make certain decisions. So there are roadblocks to effective communication and lack of time. You have to make time. Some doctors resent the time that's demanded. They feel threatened by patients that are knowledgeable. And now with the internet and learning through the internet, patients can learn quite a bit. But they've also got misconceptions which need to be adjusted for. Some doctors lack communication skills. That could be language. It could just be behavior. It could be that the cultural differences are great. Patients who choose home dialysis tend to want to stay at home. So we need to modify what they do so they can stay at home. I made the comment earlier about not disparaging the therapy. If a patient's having a problem, define the problem. Ask yourself the question, is this really insurmountable? It may seem insurmountable to that patient, but I've seen this before. Not insurmountable to me. So you've got to talk about what the problems are, try and pin down the details. Can we anticipate it? If so, can we plan an alternative? We discussed that earlier when we talked about space, when I said, gee, I've got an alternative. Why don't we have a site in a village or a city that everybody keeps their supplies there and they go there every 2 or 3 days and get them? If somebody is losing their peritoneal ability to do peritoneal dialysis, should we prepare their arm for possibility of hemodialysis? How about if we see them before they even need dialysis and we see that they have a hernia that probably should be fixed in anticipation of them wanting to perform peritoneal dialysis? Again, anticipating problems. Now, in the United States, these are data, as you can see, from only a few years ago. If you look over time, 5 years is that 60 months, the number, 100% of the patients started peritoneal dialysis at time zero, and you could see that only about 20% were still on hemodialysis at 5 years. And the good news is transplant represents a large fraction of those patients. So even in United States, peritoneal dialysis usually turns out to not be a long therapy. The longest patient I ever had on peritoneal dialysis was 18 years. And let me just say, at 18 years, she moved away. So she was still on at 18 years. I said I would come back as we wind down to what do I mean by integrated care. And I want to go over this slide again. So integrated care is as the disease progresses, they're starting to face dialysis, we educate them about their options, and then we try to help them make the therapy that might be the best initial therapy for them. And recognize that throughout the course of their lifetime with end-stage kidney disease, they are going to make transitions. Let's highlight some transitions. So here are transition points from peritoneal dialysis to hemodialysis, and on the other side, hemodialysis to peritoneal. You are going to see sometimes the same type of transition point might indicate going from one therapy to the other therapy. And so, again, it's knowing your patients, knowing what they know, knowing about them, the way they live and what's important to them, and then, of course, learning about the therapies. And, of course, these sessions with Dr. Bargman and me were to learn about the therapies. But I would argue that learning about the therapies is only part of it. Learning about your patients is absolutely, I think, the most important thing a physician can offer that patient. The integrated care is beneficial. There are now several papers on integrated care this one is out of Belgium, but there's some papers now out of the United Kingdom and some other countries, all showing the same thing. And that is that flexibility of your end-stage kidney disease program provides the best patient survival. And rather than go into the detail on this slide, I think you can all trust me that the outcomes for programs that are flexible and for patients that are flexible will be the best outcomes. So in conclusion, successful PD requires patients, physicians, and the systems to coordinate to achieve the preferred outcomes, patient satisfaction, and I think we're obligated to cost-effective care. This isn't easy. It's not at all easy. Takes an effort. And hopefully that you can learn from those of us that have been doing this for a long time. But I assure you, the gratification is worth it. And it doesn't matter about my comparisons to North America, to Africa. The similarities are greater than the differences. And I hope that you can learn from our experiences. And as I said earlier, you have my email address. I've given my slides to the organizers. You're welcome to use them and welcome to question why I said what I did. And at that, Scott, you can take off the slides and I'll answer questions.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Golper. We do have time for a few questions. Couple of questions in the chat. Apart from renal failure, what are the other indications for HD and PD? So I don't know if you want to get into that or.
I'm not sure we should. This is the right forum to do that. Clearly, life-threatening acidosis, perhaps life-threatening hyperkalemia that's not amenable to other therapies, but. I think the discussion from both Dr. Bargman and me was intended for end-stage kidney disease.
Fair enough. A question about PD for polycystic kidney disease. Your thoughts on that?
Well, I probably get that question once a week. So there are several components of polycystic kidney disease. One is space in the abdomen. Most of the time, there's space in the abdomen. That's point one. Second point is polycystics retain kidney function really well. We know that from the vitamin D and the erythropoietin standpoint, but they also from the GFR standpoint. All right. So often there's room. Sometimes one of the kidneys has to come out to make room for a transplant. But what I would do is polycystic kidney disease is not a contraindication. You might need to do low volume, and if low volume, meaning the amount of dialysate that goes in has to be low because of discomfort, then you might want to consider creating a fistula in that patient in anticipation, because when the residual kidney function goes down, as Joanne pointed out, you're going to increase the fill volumes, and then the patient might need a hemodialysis. But there's no reason that. Probably 95% of all people with polycystic kidney disease can't do PD. 95% can do PD.
Great, thank you. Someone has their hand up. I'm not sure how to address that.
That's me.
Okay, great.
Okay, I just want to make a comment. I'm a pediatrician, Dr. Golper, so I'm going to talk from a pediatric point of view. I'm not sure how much pediatric dialysis is done, but I just made a simple observation. You know, there's always this thing about choice between hemodialysis and peritoneal dialysis. And one thing I noticed was that if you want to push peritoneal dialysis, always use the mother as the primary caregiver. If you want to push hemodialysis, talk to the dad. And I always wondered why that was so. And then I realized what was one of the things is that moms like PD because if they can put the child onto a cycle or they can do an exchange between 6 and 9 o'clock, they have time to prepare supper, etc. Dad likes hemodialysis because then he can get off work for 3 times a week earlier. So, you know, it's just an observation from pediatrics. But of course, there are lots of papers on showing what the choices can be besides medical reasons. See?
Well, absolutely. And I hope I mentioned the other reasons other than medical. I sure meant to imply they're important. And thank you for educating me about that. That's kind of, and also you understand that the situation that you're referring to is fairly sophisticated.
Yes.
Hemodialysis in children is probably technically a little more complicated, but yeah, I think your point's a good point. And thank you for educating me.
There is a question on the chat about treatment of peritonitis, which is a great segue for me to hype up the ISPD website and all the guidelines that there are, because I think we're going to have a session on that. And if you need information on that, it is free guidelines on the ISPD website about treating peritonitis. So that is a good resource for that. What are the complications of HD and PD, and when is the best time to initiate a patient on the two? Again, I think complications we're going to get into in the next few weeks, so we can probably wait on that. And, you know, in terms of timing, I don't know. That's a whole separate discussion in terms of timing of renal replacement therapy, and a lot goes into it, as you've alluded. So I don't know if you have any other comments or.
So regarding that, so as Scott is pointing out, over the course of the next weeks, you're going to be having more topics discussed. I will make myself available. You have my email address. But wait until you hear those other discussants. And then if you have a question, I would be glad to work with it. And if I can't answer it, I will pick out people who can. For example, I have a close connection of pediatric nephrologists around the world if those issues come up. And I can connect you to those people if need be, but hear out those other lectures first.
Great. Thank you so much. I think that is it for the questions. We are 2 minutes over time, so not too bad. I just want to thank both of our speakers. And I really want to thank everyone at the Africa Healthcare Network for their collaboration in producing these webinars. And I will turn it over to my colleagues from the Africa Healthcare Network to close out. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Scott, for moderating the session, and also thank you to Professor Golper and Ali, I think Ali and Professor Bergman for very enlightening topics, and I think it was a very good introduction to PD in East Africa and the whole of Africa. And I think indeed those are very good learning points that we can probably use and discuss. And like you had suggested, of course, benchmark with other countries like India, China, and the rest, and see whether we can start it rolling. I think on behalf of Africa Healthcare Network, and I also want to say a big thank you to ISPD for us starting this. And I'll just want to leave it to Dr. Lloyd to have the closing remarks. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Scott. Thank you, Dr. Golper. Wonderful session. I think it's a very, very informative and a great start that we've made today. Extremely grateful to the ISPD for all the help for today, and we hope to look forward for the future sessions coming up.
Thank you, Dr. Lloyd. And just to note, we had about 100 participants listening to this. So thank you for impacting knowledge across the world, and we look forward to more sessions in the future. Thank you and good evening.